प्रपन्न पारिजाताय तोत्र वेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृत दुहे नमः ओम। डियर फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू द स्टडी ऑफ गीता। वी हैव जस्ट एंटर्ड ए वेरी टफ पोर्शन इन द भगवद गीता। वी जस्ट सॉ इन द फर्स्ट चैप्टर हाउ अर्जुन वाज रादर he got into a sort of despondent mood because he saw in front of him all his relatives, his grandfathers, his uncles, his sons and all such people who are closely related to them, with whom he was brought up and with whom he was playing and with whom he was dining and all that, such very very close friends with whom he has to fight. And then he said nakanshe vijayam krishna etc etc, and then he said no, I don't want to do this, I don't want to do this war, and I want to get back to some sort of bhikshatanam. Bhikshatanam is actually not the dharma of a kshatriya. Bhikshatanam was the dharma prescribed for a brahmana, I was telling you. So he is at that confused level, and Krishna actually laughed at him, and then now Krishna is actually giving him a very very strong dose of Vedanta. So that is exactly where we are. And in fact Gita, the very first few shlokas of Krishna, they are really tough. And in fact Gita, if you overcome these shlokas, about 15-20 shlokas which talk about what is the self, what is the nature of the self, then the rest of the Gita is easy. For example, if you just listen to the next 4-5 sessions carefully and also patiently, you should not get disheartened, oh Bhagavad Gita is so sad and so serious etc etc. If you just overcome this first, the next 5 episodes or so, then the next things will be easy because everything will be based on this. So Krishna is telling the essence of Vedanta in the very first 20 shlokas. So Bhagavad Gita is somewhat like a sort of obstacle course, where usually in the obstacle course you move from a small, an easier obstacle to a bigger obstacle. So here it is a reverse case. That is, you get the toughest obstacle in the very beginning, and after you cross, then other things they fall in place, and then other things they are easy. So first try to overcome the big obstacle. I will try to make it as easy as possible, because I am not reading the commentaries. If I read the comment, of course I have read the commentaries, I have also taught them as I said earlier, but now I am not reading the commentary because it will be very very tough for you. I am only summarizing and trying to put it in very very easy terms. So that is what I am planning to do. We were actually seeing the shloka number 12. Initially first 11 shloka, from shloka number 11 Krishna has started, that is second adhyaya shloka number 11. He said ashochyan anvashochastvam, you are grieving for those who deserve to be grieved. Then the next shloka says natve vaham jatunasam natvam neme janadipah, there was never a time when you did not exist, there was never a time when I did not exist, there is not going to be a time when I will not exist, there will not be any time when you will not exist. That means all of us, we exist at all times. So that means you and me are all eternal. So that is what he says. So this is the overall context here. If you see the overall context and you just recapitulate, Arjuna forgot his swadharma and he was thinking of his other dharma, paradharma. And this is something which can happen. Why are we reading this? Because such a situation can happen to us also. Such a situation can happen to us when we face some sort of critical situation. Then, okay, I will not handle this, I will rather quit. So that is what we may say. But this is quitting a sort of assigned task, quitting your own dharma, also it leads to sin. And anybody, even if you are following your own dharma, normally what happens is, while following our own dharma, we do various activities. And by those various activities, we attain some punyam, papam, and we get lot of karma, phala, as we say. The word karma means two things, that is both action and also the result of action. So this word karma is used in both senses. Depending on the context, we have to understand. So we are accumulating a lot of karma, which means karma phala, the fruit of that karma. And in order to experience the fruit of that karma phala, we have to take birth again and again and again. So that will go on and on. Then what is liberation? Freedom from that cycle of samsara is what is called a liberation. And if you want to attain this freedom, what are we supposed to do? you have to attain Atmajnana, that is the self-knowledge. And what is this self-knowledge? Self-knowledge is examining or understanding your own role in a larger context. Not in a very small context, not in a very, very narrow context, but in a very large, in a bigger context. And what is this small context and what is the bigger context? For example, I say, I am so-and-so, I belong to so-and-so village, and I belong to a particular community, okay, I am a Brahmana. And even in the Brahmana, there are so many sects, half a dozen or maybe 100 sects. So I belong to this particular sect, particular sect. And there again, I am something like a Vaidika, Niyogi, etc., etc. So suppose I define myself and I belong to this religion, etc., etc. I am defining myself in a very small role. Suppose I slightly become, I expand my self. And I say, I am an Indian. I am not a Brahmana, I am not a Kshatriya, I am an Indian, etc. Then I am slightly expanded myself. Then I don't even have that Indian identity. I don't limit myself. And I treat everybody as, everybody in the world as my own brother and sister. So then I become a citizen of the world. So that is one slightly bigger level. And then again, at a philosophical level, if you see, I consider myself as the body-mind complex. Body-mind complex is that is okay. I am having a particular body. I am having a particular social identity, and I am also having some sort of intellectual attainments, etc. So all these things they constitute my identity, and this is what is a limited context. A larger context means in relation to this supreme reality. In relation to this universe, what are you? You are a microcosm which is a product of the macrocosm. You are only a manifestation in that macrocosm. And this whole macrocosm of the universe which we are talking about is only a manifestation in the creative power of that supreme reality. And what is that supreme reality? It is not different from you. You are that supreme reality. So this is that larger context. When I understand myself in the larger context, I understand Vedanta says that you are not different from Brahman. In fact, you are that Brahman. Like a wave in a ocean, the most common example which Vedantins give is that of a wave. A small wave, a small ripple in the ocean. That small ripple in the ocean, it develops an identity. Oh, I am a wave, I have got this sort of wavelength, and then this, I don't remember the physics aspect of it, that radius of, not radius of curvature, wavelength and amplitude, whatever it is. So suppose it defines itself like that, and it feels jealous of a bigger wave, and a bigger wave comes and hits it and it gets beaten, it gets rather angry. So this is the wave identity. And the wave, suppose it realizes that it is ocean itself, it is not different from the ocean. And wave is water only. Even a bubble is water only. Even the small froth which we see in the ocean, that froth also is water. Everything is water. So suppose the wave, small ripple, realizes that it is ocean, then that is what is called realization. So with that realization, what happens? That realization, Vedanta says, it leads you to the breakaway from this samsara. This samsara or this transmigration has been going on because you have been identifying yourself. And once that identity is gone, then there is the linga sharira, it dissolves. This linga sharira keeps on, linga sharira means this subtle body keeps on demanding a newer body because it has not exhausted its karma. And once you realize that you are not this body-mind complex, then this linga sharira, it actually automatically dissolves. It no more demands a body. Till the time you are enlightened, the linga sharira demands a new body. And you keep on getting this transmigration and a newer body. Newer means another body. So that again becomes old and you discard it and then get into another body. So this is what is called the higher level of realizing one's own self. So this is what is the overall context. And in this overall context, we are seeing now what Krishna is saying. Krishna is saying that we were all eternal. We are all eternal in this shloka number 12. He is saying, Natvevaham jatunasam, natvam neme. There was never a time when you did not exist. There was never a time when I did not exist. And there will be no time when we will never exist. So, sarvevayam atah param. We have always existed and we will always exist. And we are what is called a nitya. Nitya means eternal. So, how are we eternal? That is our basic question. How am I eternal? And how am I undying? Because we see every day we see people just somebody is born and somebody dies. So we are seeing somebody is growing up, somebody is becoming old, somebody is becoming very decrepit and unable to move, and somebody is bubbling with youth and enthusiasm. So we see all these things. So how is it that we are eternal? And when we say we are eternal, what is it that is eternal in us? So that is what we have to analyze. So Vedanta analyzes it. And I just spoke to you about what is called the social ego. Social ego is, I belong to this particular, my name is so-and-so. I am a male. I am like this. I have so many educational qualifications. I have produced so many papers or something like that. And I belong to a particular caste, community, religion and whatnot. This is my social identity. So Vedanta examines all these things and then it says, this cannot be your real self. And what exactly is your real self? So for that, Vedanta analyzes all human experience, all this social self. This is for social purposes, it is okay. But when you say I, for social, all social transaction, etc., this social identity is okay. Because when you go to a passport office, you have to present yourself. Or rather, when you go to some place, you need a visa and you need a passport and whatnot. All those things, you can't say, I am Brahma and I can go anywhere. I am all pervading, etc., etc. So the social identity may be there. But what is our real identity? So Vedanta examines it in a different way. We'll just take a break and resume. We will resume now. The identity is, the Vedanta examines like this. All human experience, if we see, all human experience is at three levels. For example, now we are awake. And all through the day we are awake usually, all through the day we are awake. And all through the day we do so many activities, we are engaged in so many activities, meet maybe many people, sometimes hundreds of people, interact with several people. And we do so many activities and we see so many things. And there is an experience of lot many things. You interact with that, you go to a pizza place and then eat a pizza and then go to some other place and then have some coffee. Now all these things you experience. And in all these experiences, there is what is called your own consciousness. Suppose you are speaking to somebody. What is at the back of it? At the back of it is your what is called intelligence or consciousness, which is making you to interact. Suppose you are sipping coffee. And that coffee is so nice. And you are enjoying that coffee. And who is enjoying that coffee? That you are enjoying, there is no, the body-mind complex is enjoying, no doubt. But how is it enabled? It is enabled by the consciousness. The same consciousness enables you to interact with your friend. The same consciousness enables you to interact with somebody in the office. The same consciousness enables you to enjoy a coffee. So the objects may be different. But the consciousness behind it in all, the same consciousness is there behind all experiences. And it is the same consciousness when you smell a good thing, the same consciousness when you take a sip of coffee, and the same consciousness when you listen to something. So the objects of experience may differ. The external objects or sense objects, as we call them, the objects of experience may differ. But the consciousness behind them or intelligence behind them is the same, is one and the same. So this is applicable to all the people, all animals, all beings, all living beings. Then what is the second stage? The waking stage, all human experience, as I said, it is analyzed, it can be brought down to three stages only. That is the waking state, the dream state, and the deep sleep state. All this is being examined. Why are we making this examination? Because we want to see what is that undying thing in you. Now this gentleman Krishna is saying that you are always there. There is something, you are always there, I am always there, etc., etc. Then what is that undying thing? So for that we are doing this analysis. So during the waking state, whatever we see, whatever we examine, whatever experience, sensory experience we have, the same intelligence is there behind every sense every sensory experience. And you go to the dream state. And in the dream state, usually the sense organs are withdrawn. Sense organs means the sense of sight, the sense of touch, the sense of smell, the sense of hearing. So these the sense of taste. So these five senses, they are withdrawn. They are withdrawn. And most of the time, of course, sometimes there is some little bit of some sensory perception also. And that sensory perception may also lead to some sort of distortion in the dream, or the dream can go in a different direction. But even when the senses are withdrawn, the mind is still active and the mind is projecting its own world. And the mind is projecting its own world where from? There is a lot of discussion about the dream. In fact, we think that this dream analysis, etc., has come in the modern sociology only, psychology. In fact, if you see the dream, the discussion on this dream in the Upanishads, Upanishadic literature, the commentaries on Upanishads, and again in the Buddhist philosophy, particularly in the Buddhist philosophy, there is a lot of discussion on this dream state and Sushupti state. Similarly, in this Upanishadic philosophy, there is a lot of discussion. So this dream and Sushupti, they were examined in order to examine the nature of consciousness. I was telling you in the beginning, this examination of consciousness was not done by the Western philosophy. In fact, Swami Ramatirtha, he observes, his books on Vedanta are very, very famous. Ramatirtha's books, of course, I have read only very little of that, some excerpts here and there. But my guru, he quotes Ramatirtha very much. My guru Tattvavidhanandaji, he quotes Ramatirtha very much. And he says that in the woods of self-realization, there are certain volumes, the woods of self-realization, I recommend to you. I have read a few portions of it, not the entire text. And the Swami Ramatirtha says, the Western philosophy has and as a student of Western philosophy, I can also say the same thing. Western philosophy, right from Plato, except Plato. Plato is the only man who examined what is called consciousness, what is called the mind. Later, Plato's student Aristotle, and thereafter, right down to 18th century, all the philosophers, they examined only the external world. And only in the 18th century, then only, most probably because this 18th century was called the age of enlightenment for the entire Europe. Because at that time they were all exposed to the Upanishadic literature. And 18th century enlightenment is directly related to the exposure of the Western world to the Upanishadic literature. And in fact, on this point, I recommend you one book called The American Veda, or The Impact of Vedanta on the West. The Impact of Vedanta on the West, if you go to YouTube and see, you will get a few talks. And there is a book called American Veda by one gentleman called Philip Goldberg. He also tells how these Upanishads have come to the Western world. And also one Swamiji of Ramakrishna Mutt, one Tathagatananda, he has also written a book called Journey of Upanishads to the West. So if you see those books, we will see how the Western world, the intellectuals were influenced by that. And from that only, from that time onwards, they started talking about what is mind. And somebody says mind is a tabula rasa, it is a clean slate, etc. And David Hume and others, they were all very fully conversant with the Upanishads. And Schopenhauer, etc., some others, they openly acknowledged, they praised. So Schopenhauer particularly praises Upanishads so much. So that is particularly the thing. All this I digressed because I was telling about the psychology. It is not only modern psychology which discusses this dream state. If we see our own Upanishads, the Upanishads, they talk about the dream state. Right from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. And if you go to the Buddhists also, the oldest Buddhist texts, they also talk about the waking state, dream state, and deep sleep state. So in this dream, what happens? In this dream, the mind, it has got various impressions which are there embedded in it. All these latent impressions of various sensory experiences. And with all these sensory experiences, it creates its own world. It again projects them in a different way. And you have a separate identity there. And it looks so real. Suppose you are interacting with somebody, sometimes there may be pleasant dreams, sweet dreams, sometimes there may be very, very tough dreams. So all that is so real. Sometimes in a very bad mood you wake up, sometimes you wake up in a very pleasant mood. So this dream state, that is again something which is a projection of the mind. There also the objects of the dream, they change, but the consciousness does not change. Consciousness in it, the same intelligence does not change. And again, after that dream condition, which is in which still the mind also is active, we go to the next stage. Quite often, many people, they don't get very deep sleep, but quite some lucky people, they do get very deep sleep also. And in the deep sleep, even the mind is withdrawn, totally mind is withdrawn, and Vedanta says that the mind itself take rest through in some particular nadi called Puritata nadi. So of course, I will not go into that. So the mind itself takes rest. Nadi means a nerve. After all, it is all a nervous system only. It says that the mind also takes rest in a particular nerve maybe. So there, what happens? There we don't see anything because the mind is needed. If you want to know anything, the mind is needed. And even when you are projecting a world of its own, either during daydream also can happen. Whether it is a daydream or a night dream, the mind is needed. But in the deep sleep, the mind also is not there. Mind is withdrawn. Then the question is consciousness there or not? And Vedanta, it very logically examines it and then says, even in the deep sleep, consciousness is always there. Consciousness never leaves. Even in the dead body, of course, consciousness is there. The mind is not there. So the dead body is not going about its activities. Otherwise, it will go about its activities. Mind and senses are not there, and the prana is not there. So anyway, in the deep sleep, what happens? When you wake up from the deep sleep, you say, "Oh, I slept so well, I didn't know anything." And you also say, "It was so nice, I did not know anything, I didn't know anything. But I was so happy, I felt that bliss." So there is an experience of that happiness. There is an experience that you did not know anything. There is an experience of ignorance. There is an experience of bliss. And this experience can take place only when there is consciousness. And this is again a smriti. Smriti means a recollection, isn't it? When you wake up, you are recalling that you are happy. Right now you may not be happy, but you on that deep sleep you are happy. So that recollection of bliss is there means recollection can be there only when there is an experience. And experience can be there only when there is consciousness. So this sort of logic goes on. We need not go into the deep logic. So there is the way Vedanta very logically shows that even in the deep sleep, that consciousness is there. So in all throughout the three states of human experience, consciousness has always been there. So this is the point. And this is not only applicable for one day, it is applicable for the week, it is applicable for the fortnight, applicable for the month, applicable for the year, applicable for the entire life, and applicable to all the humanity, all time. And consciousness is something which does not generate at one point of time, which does not originate at some point of time. Nodeti nastametyesha, says sage Vidyaranya in Panchadashi. There is a book called Vedanta Panchadashi. In that Panchadashi, sage Vidyaranya says, Nodeti nastametyesha. That is, this consciousness is something which has no origin and which has no end. Suppose somebody says consciousness was born at this point of time. Suppose some thousand billions and billions of years ago, this consciousness was born. Then who witnessed that origin of that consciousness? And whoever has witnessed it, that entity has to be a conscious entity. It can't be an inert entity. And if that conscious entity also originated at some point of time, who saw that thing? There is a need for a witness for that origin also. So it goes into what is called an infinite regress. That infinite regress, it is something which it only shows that this is originless. It is always there. And what about its death? Nobody can say consciousness has died. If somebody says consciousness has died or ceased to exist, then it has to be noticed by a witness only. And if that consciousness, if that witness also dies, you need witness number two to witness the death of the number two, number one witness. Then to witness the death of number two witness, you need another witness number three. So who is also a conscious entity. Again, it is another infinite regress in the other direction. So consciousness is something which is always present. And you and I, we are nothing but, we are all consciousness, like that wave example I gave. Like the wave realizes that it is not a mere, say, independent, it is not something which is having an independent form and a name and all that. Its essential nature, okay, it may be having a name and form. For all transactional purposes, it is okay. And it is feeling jealous of a bigger wave and whatnot, and it is also loving a smaller wave. It is okay. But essentially, what is its nature? Essentially, its nature is, it is nothing but water. So that is what is the realization. So this human experience in all the three stages, it is examined. And the final conclusion of Vedanta is that you are that consciousness, you are not different from that consciousness. And what we call that absolute reality, it is also of that nature, it is that consciousness alone. So that is what we are going to see in the next shloka also. That absolute reality is not a person. When we say, when we come to Vedanta, we have to forget our other notions about God. So whether Krishna is the real God, or whether Shiva is the real God, or whether Ganesha is the real God, we have to forget. All these are names and forms in one supreme reality. You are Krishna, you are Ganesha, you are some other God of some other religion. All these are names and forms. God, all people are gods with some functions. And all these are names and forms in one supreme consciousness. And you are not different from that. And you are that, that is what is called chit. This Chaitanya, in Vedanta, we call it chit. So this chit is something which is also sat, which is also all constantly existing. We saw just now, I explained to you, how this consciousness is something which is existing all through. So the same consciousness and existence, that chit and sat are you. So that is what the Vedanta says. We'll continue tomorrow. Harihi Om Tat Sat.